In the year 1997, the future is in chaos and turmoil. Mankind is on the brink of extinction. Brave survivors band together and build a time displacement apparatus to receive a signal from a parallel future. This transmission is the Vundacast.
Official podcast of Vundablog.com, the home of whatever, the podcast that that is really happy and went into The Last Jedi totally satisfied because his only expectation was that Niednub make it till the end and survive, and maybe now he'll be general, you know? Cause he's probably the highest ranking.
Niednub is the fish face guy.
Yeah.
I've always wanted to know what his name was.
He made it all the way. He was also in the Venture Brothers. He was.
Oh yeah, that's right.
He was brought forth into the world through magical summonings.
Yeah.
So I am your host, Steven. Welcome to the Vundacast. Now you are sitting here in the 101st episode. Of the Vundacast, well, epic times.
So this is going to be posted before any of the other
things that we've done. Yeah, I'm probably going to post the Jericho thing next.
Yeah.
Actually,
because that's relevant to, like, now.
To now. And then everything else will get...
Everything else is, like, from...
Get spread out.
Best matches of 2017.
Yeah. So, as you can hear, the dulcet tones of the World Podcast Heavyweight... Tag Team Lucha,
Gift of the Gods Champion.
Gift of the Gods Champion.
The Re-Gift of the Gods Champion.
D-Rock is here with us to talk about some Last Jedi.
Some Star Wars.
And the Co-hortress Chicken Nugget, Danielle. The new, she told me I could call her Reylo from now on. Danielle's here to talk about Reylo today.
Co-hortress
and The Last Jedi.
Call me Danielle Reylo Johnson.
Danielle Reylo Johnson. Oh no, Reylo Johnson.
Reylo Johnson is what we're calling Ryan Johnson.
Ryan Johnson.
Calling Ryan Reylo Johnson.
Yeah. You can get your name back.
Co-hortress Reylo Chicken McNugget.
It's getting a little upset. It's getting a little obscene now.
What you need is like Snoke to be like. Arise, Co-hortress of the Vundacast, the one master of the chicken nuggets.
No, man, he's not even a Sith. He doesn't have no authority over religious rights.
Yeah, he doesn't.
Of naming.
He comes up, he's pretty good.
That's a good question, though. Did he give the name Kylo Ren? Or did Kylo... pick the name?
These are my headcanons.
So you're already totally
on left field. Well, today we're going to talk about The Last Jedi, which is the new film that Disney released upon the Earth.
But just don't forget I have a headcanon about that.
I think we're 3 or 4 weeks out from the release of the actual film. So needless to say, we are totally spoiler filled.
Yeah.
We're going to hold nothing back. If you haven't seen this film by now, then I'm sure you've been spoiled, because the spoilers
are everywhere. If you haven't seen the movie by now, any spoilers are your own choice.
Yes, it's been almost a month.
Yeah.
I
feel like you get a week.
Yeah.
And if you haven't seen it within a week, you don't care enough not to be spoiled.
Not to spoil, exactly. I'm sorry. Like, especially something this in the cultural zeitgeist. Like, everyone wants to talk about it. You really have to just fucking...
Plus, the anticipation for Star Wars isn't just, like...
It's so high.
You know, it's not like people knew about this movie like 2 months ago and are excited.
No,
like,
yeah.
This has been several years
of
building, you know? Like, the only reason Rogue One even came out was so that, like, people wouldn't just go rabid thinking about Episode 8.
Yeah, right.
That's okay. kind of how
and
it feels.
Didn't work.
That's kind of how it feels with all these like in between movies. They're just like, yeah. here you go.
Just hear it.
Just calm the fuck down.
Chew on this yeah, for a while. It's like a dog. Here, chew on this bone while I do my fucking taxes.
Yeah. Rogue One was really good, and I really liked Rogue One. But I felt like
I loved Rogue One.
Rogue One needed like maybe like 2 weeks, even like a week and a half to digest. When The Last Jedi,
it's
a month out, still feels very rich in layered things to digest and think about.
I think everyone here has seen it at least.
I've seen it three times.
I've seen it six times. Steven has seen it seven times.
Eight times now.
Jesus.
Ocho, and for the eight, for eight. The Last Jedi. The only movie that I've seen this many times.
I've never seen a movie this many times.
Is when
theaters.
I saw the J.J. Abrams film.
Star Trek.
I saw it 11 times because it was the 11th Star Trek film.
Oh, man.
But granted, I slept through half of those.
The most I've seen a movie in theaters is probably like four times because I just can never get around to.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
I saw episode 3 four times in the theaters because I love episode 3.
This movie
maybe
had
I can
me...
wax about my love of episode 3 in this podcast.
Well, part of the beauty
and
of
Dark Knight.
Yeah.
Part of the beauty of this movie, as opposed to The Force Awakens, is that this movie feels like it like acknowledges like the entirety
of Star Wars.
Of Star Wars,
yeah.
And the mythology that's in it.
Absolutely.
Mm-hmm.
I really do think that, you know, a lot of people have been saying this. This point has been made, but it bears repeating that the first movie had a lot to do in terms of giving people what they wanted, which
right.
was a Star Wars that they remembered from when they were 10.
Which even they complained about.
Yeah, even that they complained
yeah.
about.
It's too much like Star Wars.
It's too derivative.
But people definitively wanted a Star Wars
that
was
felt
not the prequel,
yeah.
but was more like the original
exactly.
trilogy.
Yeah.
But the so J.J. Abrams had to do a lot with that movie. Like you were saying, he had to familiarize us with Star Wars and be like, remember Star Wars,
right.
guys? Remember R2-D2 and C-3PO? All
and
your friends
Han
are here.
Solo.
And Han Solo, look at him, he's fancy.
And he's in the Millennium Falcon.
It was really important.
And he had to set up a bunch of new characters.
I think
yeah,
it was really...
And get you to like them immediately.
I think that it was,
like,
you know, it was one of those things that I think that it was very smart of them to recognize they were going to have to bring in the old people because...
Mm.
You know, yes, people are excited.
People are excited about
Star Wars, and they would have seen it anyway. But I still don't think it wouldn't have done as well if it didn't have Mark Hamill, Harrison Ford, Carrie Fisher, Anthony Daniels,
yeah,
and all those
so
guys in there.
By the prequels,
yeah, by the prequels, they felt so disassociated to what Star Wars was. To have those people come in and be like, "No, guys, this is your Star Wars."
Right. Yeah.
It was something that was like essential. So imagine having to juggle that, plus having to go, okay, but these are not the people you're going to be watching for the next 6 years. You're going to have to pay attention to these young kids because they're the ones taking over the fucking ship.
The thing about these movies as opposed to the prequels too is that like these movies have Han, Luke, and Leia who are different than they were in the original trilogy, but they're like natural...
totally
from
natural
the current point, and they're still kind of operating within their same character range.
Wow.
While the prequels, like the characters that we know from the original trilogy,
were not like
that are
what
in the
we
prequels,
would, we
aren't
of.
Acting in any way what they did. Like Yoda's not as impish at all.
No, he's very stoic
in
and
the
serious.
Prequel trilogy at all.
Mm-hmm.
Like part of the fun of the Last Jedi's Yoda scene was that
Anakin
Yoda was impish again.
Anakin is a whiny teenager, which
yeah.
like everyone was very like. So the people don't like to have things demystified. I
yeah.
find,
but
which
yet
is a,
they
which
all.
Which is something
but,
that people
but what's
hated
hilarious,
about.
What's hilarious is they love to say they don't want things demystified.
Right.
But then, as is the case with the people who have been detracting this movie. Kind of sounds like you want everything explained to
yeah,
you
right.
with like fucking you know Venn diagrams and
yeah.
like fucking Excel spreadsheets because the
yeah.
way that they've been talking about some of the stuff in this movie, it's like the idea of mystery is appalling to them.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Right.
Or the idea of like not always knowing everything is appalling to them. I think the prequels. I am one of those people who has. I would not write off the prequels ever, because I essentially believe. that the core idea of what the story is about, which is the failure of the Jedi to save Anakin Skywalker, and the love story between Padme and Anakin are actually very compelling and interesting stories. It's just they were executed poorly and very clunky and badly written dialogue.
In some aspects.
So that you emotionally, you were always kind of emotionally distant. It was only the third movie that really kind of drove home some of that emotional center.
Right.
But even still, the dialogue was clunky as fuck.
Yeah.
You know, and it could have been, it's just sitting there thinking about it, if Rian Johnson and J.J. Abrams had had the prequels, that would have been the most tragic, fucked up love story with the most depressing, like, we would walk out of there like, ha! And I already, like, wept. When they executed Order 66 in Revenge of the Sith, I wept. That was actually one of the most, if not the most effective part of the entire prequel trilogy, was watching them kill the Jedi.
The music, the montage.
That was horrifying. That was, like,
the music was
beautiful. That was another thing, too, is that that's actually, like, I think, definitely, like, the first montage, like, musical montage in Star Wars, like, history, you know?
And I think the best actor,
where you're jumping to different places,
yeah,
and
that was actually, yeah, they don't do montages.
They never did, like, a big,
no,
like,
that was a montage.
Operatic thing, you're right,
they never do montages.
They should do that again in episode
The music is so perfect, too, though, which is, like, I remember that was another one of the reasons that I like episode 3 a lot more than most
music
people do.
The
music
is beautiful.
It's so dark and beautiful, and like, I listened to that soundtrack.
I think that to
for
me
months after.
It's just, I don't know, I feel like a lot of times when it comes to Star Wars analysis, I really do think that what Yoda says in The Last Jedi is so accurate to a lot of fans. You always look, never hear.
Never hear what's right in front of your nose.
You know what I mean? I think it's so important because they don't read the actual text of the film. You know what I mean? They're reading a theory over here, or an EU book over here, or a comic book over here, or some detailed schematic on a spaceship over here.
How can
They're not reading into the narrative, mytho-poetic themes of the story.
Right.
And when you do that, you recognize you have to listen to everything. John Williams' score is essential to understanding so much of Star Wars.
Absolutely.
And even I can't always get it because, you know, I'm don't play an instrument, but I'm a singer. I can hear music. But obviously, as a musician, to hear those things, you know, but like when I start listening to it with the perspective of musicians and even just paying attention, you see so much, and it's so important. And I think that's part of the problem, is I feel like they look outside of these movies instead of looking into them, which is one of the reasons why, you know, just to start my first of probably 55,000 Reylo points, is that the first movie, The Force Awakens, so many people saw the Reylo, the Rey and Kylo Ren dynamic, and they're sitting there going, what the fuck are you talking about? Because they weren't looking at what the movie was showing them. And even the music, you know, there's a sequence where John Williams, when he picks her up and takes her to his spaceship, there's a small section right there that he uses the Tchaikovsky overture from Romeo and Juliet. Somebody fucking caught that put it in a video. And when I'm sitting there, you know, listening to it, I'm like, holy shit. Like, that is significant. And that's what and that's so important to, like, really look at Star Wars that way. Look at the mythopoetic themes. Look at the music. And you're and like that. And exactly, John Williams, like, really used in Revenge of the Sith that music to tell the tragedy.
Yeah.
He was like, you know, this, he probably in his mind was like, the script is not that great, but I'm gonna fucking play the shit out of this.
Yeah.
You're gonna cry anyway, motherfuckers. Like, like, you know, I'm gonna not let you walk out of here with a dry eye.
Even the music with, like, when Vader comes up in that apparatus and that, like, super operatic music. And Padme's funeral and all these different things.
It was beautiful. And
happening.
And it does, the Revenge of the Sith, it makes me sad because it's like, it was, you know, it gave you a kind of an inkling of, like, man, if only they had tried to try a little harder.
There's glimpses.
Not say yes to George so much.
Yeah. Well, there's glimpses in that movie of great directing, yes, and great acting. Ian McDermott. Ian McDermott in that movie is brilliant.
A genius.
I love it.
And Hayden Christensen, that fight scene with Obi-Wan Kenobi.
That's intense.
It's fucking emotional. That is shit. So emotional. When he's crawling on the floor and he's like, I hate you. Yeah. You're just like,
where they're on the table and he grabs his arm and he's trying to kill him with his own lightsaber, and he has this look on his face of just like intensity that's like so good.
It's sad because you really do feel like you see the glimpses and you just wish.
And the Yoda Emperor fight is so well directed. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. I heard that Steven Spielberg directed
it. It is well directed. The way they use the darkness and the shadow to kind of, you know, and
the thing in the Senate coming up from the floor. And
it's a much more desperate fight than like when he fights with Dooku, you know? Like,
right. He's doing backflips and shit.
But he's really trying to survive. Like, he recognizes the skill of the Emperor. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, like, Revenge of the Sith is something, like, I don't think that, I think, it's not that I don't think you're a fan if you didn't like the way the prequels were executed, but I really do think that if you want to just ignore them, especially in the context of these movies, you're doing yourself a disservice to the story. Understanding George Lucas's vision, and you're not understanding Lucasfilm's vision, fuck it, because they're the ones running the show now.
That's another reason why I love Revenge of the Sith so much, is that it goes into that theme of Palpatine is so perfect. Mm-hmm. Talking to Anakin about, you can't just look at the dogmatic view of the Jedi. If you want to understand the great mystery, you have to understand all aspects of it. And talking about how the Jedi also only crave power.
Yeah.
Because he's saying because that
they do.
And it's true. It's 100% true.
It's 100% true.
He's telling him true things. Yes. Nothing but true things. Yeah. So it's like, wow, you really identify. I identified it with it a lot. I was like, he's telling him the truth.
He's
not lying to him at all.
The only thing he possibly is lying to him about is the idea that you could bring someone back from the dead. But who knows if he's lying about
that?
Exactly. Because isn't Darth
Vader... The only thing he ever lies to him about is that he killed Padme.
Yes.
Oh, shit.
The only thing. Santia pointed this out to me. That's the only thing he ever lies about.
Yeah.
Because Palpatine, unlike the Jedi, unlike the Senate, unlike anybody else in the galaxy, apparently, understands how trust works.
Yes.
That you have to give it
to get it. Exactly.
And the Jedi did not do that shit with Anakin. They didn't
trust
him
at all. They put
him
at arm's length. But yet, that's what was crazy, is the Jedi fucking comes to this boy, tells him he's the Messiah.
The chosen one.
And then they start pushing him away. And it's like, they don't understand how to do, like, what? Like,
much conflict within their ranks
about how they should treat this kid and how they should do it. And I mean, and I just, at the end of the day, I really do think it also kind of illuminates the point that I think you really can look at Star Wars throughout all of the movies now and see a theme of that there are a lot of orphans everywhere. And these orphans, it's a cycle of trauma. There's the stormtroopers now are orphans. They're child soldiers. So you have this cycle of trauma coming through there. You have the orphans of, like, Anakin basically becomes an orphan because his mother is taken away from him. You know, Kylo becomes an orphan because his parents kind of neglect and abandon him a little bit. I mean, they try to do their best, but they're neglectful they're kind of like, and then Luke betrays him, so he feels like he has nobody, and it's like, oh, and then what happens to these orphans? These surrogate parents try to come in and weave their fucking spell and make them do terrible things.
Exactly,
you know, even Phasma could be looked at as a surrogate parent to Finn.
Look what the situation is with her parents too.
Some of the backstory stuff, I watched a behind the scenes of the fight between Kylo Ren, Finn, and Rey in The Force Awakens, and they were talking, and I also some supplementary material. The FN unit was trained specifically by Captain Phasma, and Finn was the honor student.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, so that's one of the reasons why they're so emotional about him defecting, because he wasn't just some stormtrooper.
So why was he wearing sanitation?
Because, I mean, they all had their jobs. They all had their jobs, but, like, J.J. Abrams came out and said
maybe he chose that.
Yeah, and also because, remember, they chose... he hadn't seen combat. That was his first combat mission, and that's why he defected.
Right.
And so they probably put him in
sanitation.
Probably put him in. Yeah, they put him in sanitation as what? He's in the military.
No, they break you.
They break you. Yeah, what do they do? Yeah. They make you they make you a custodian. I'm sure all the other stormtroopers were doing shit like that too. They're not just And so, so the thing is that, like, Finn has this specific training. And so for him to break against the mold and go away, like, was a betrayal. So, like, you can kind of look at it like she looked at him like, it's not parenting because they're not parents. But it is kind of like that surrogate parent of Phasma, which is one of the reasons why, he feels so, thing about, fighting her and, and, the fact that he was so like, I'm in charge of Phasma. I'm in charge. Mm-hmm. Obviously, that's not just coming from him being funny. He's probably had to deal with her his whole life.
Yeah.
And he's fucking like, I'm in charge now. Yeah, you can't tell me what to do and make me do things and go over here and shit.
What if the Darth Plagueis bringing people back from the dead thing is the end of episode 9?
Oh, my God.
The love of Rey.
What if Darth Plagueis does stuff? Listen,
what if Rey loves Kylo so much that after she fucking kills him, she fucking revives him? Huh?
That would not land well, I feel like.
I feel that would be really... Yeah, I don't know, man.
She could bring him back from the dead?
It's like Rapunzel.
That would be really...
That would raise a lot of questions.
Yeah.
Less answers.
You've already pushed the Force,
Yeah, but...
So far.
But that's what I'm saying, though. You've already pushed
Darth
the Force.
Darth Plagueis, he had to, work for, probably decades or whatever to even...
Maybe the way to bring someone back from the dead is when, the light side and the dark side of the Force, truly love each other.
I mean, I think it's interesting to see...
What if their true love unlocks even more power?
I think it's really interesting, this theme that they're really exploring of balance is really interesting to me. And I was going back to what I was saying about episode 3. That's kind of, a low-key theme that they explore with the Emperor and what the stuff that he's telling Anakin, even though he's just manipulating him. But they're really exploring that a lot more, especially with The Last Jedi, is all about that. This idea of, light and dark need to be balanced. When Luke talks about how after, the Empire fell and all of that stuff, he says there was balance for a while. And if you think about it, there wasn't balance, actually.
No.
They defeated the dark side. That's light was in control for a while.
That's not
the
balance.
And he read that as balance, but that's not balance.
Exactly, that's not balance.
And that's why, Snoke says, the light rises, the dark always rises to meet it.
Exactly.
The light rises.
And that's
the
thing, too, looking at these movies again. And let's, the discourse of the fanboy rage, fandom rage. Let's just say fandom to be gender neutral. The fandom, because it is everybody.
Yeah.
It's not just, the fandom rage. The fandom rage. Like the Phantom Menace.
The
Fandom Menace!
Oh my
perfect.
God, that's a great...
That's it! The Fandom Menace. That's a great
that's
podcast.
That's a great title.
Yeah, it is. Oh, we claim it! Copyright, Fandom Menace. Anyway...
But that's a documentary about the rage of Star Wars fans, the fandom menace.
No, and what? You could actually do a very interesting documentary about that because, Jake Lloyd stopped acting because of Star Wars.
Really?
And Hayden Christensen actually took a long break because of the amount of vitriol that they received from those movies. Wow. And now it's happening.
So messed up.
And now it's happening again.
There's a YouTube channel called The Fandom Menace.
We thought we thought of it already.
Damn it.
Fandom Menace, Why You're Still Okay If You Dislike The Last Jedi. Fandom Menace, What We're Really Owed From Our Favorite Star Wars.
I guess it makes sense that we couldn't possibly be
the
first
ones. No, not at all.
We invented it! No, screw you!
We invented it.
We didn't know about any
of
these things.
No, we didn't know.
Yeah. So,
and all of those places sound like things I would never visit and read because fuck you and your bitchy, whiny behavior.
You don't
anyway.
Read Forbes or Collider?
I do read Forbes.
Or the Acolyte, or the
I didn't know they used the title of the Phantom Menace.
Tor.com.
Okay, we get your point. And those were those are old. Those are 2011 articles. So that's
one is 2011, 2017.
So we're bringing it back.
2017.
We're
bringing
it back. Yeah, that's 2017, January 2017.
We can call December.
That one's December. December. Okay,
we're bringing it back.
We're bringing it back.
We can call our podcast Phantom Menace.
Yeah. But, like, it's... it's just, look, you have to, like... I lost my point. It doesn't matter.
The Phantom Menace!
The Phantom Menace!
Okay, five things that you liked about this movie.
Let's start. Let's go with some positivity.
All right, I'll start.
We're going to end on negativity.
All right, I'm going to be negative. I liked a vast more things than five things about this movie.
You got to pick a top five.
But I would have to say in the top five would have to be Luke getting on the Millennium Falcon once again, walking into the cockpit, seeing it all light up,
mm-hmm.
and then talking to R2, and then R2 fucking pulling out the old school Leia hologram.
It's a cheap move.
Like, it was just like such a genius way to to call back to the old stuff while showing, like, how this character has, like, grown so much, which was a moment they used a lot with Luke, especially, like, with the twin sons and stuff at the end.
Yeah, I love that his interaction with R2, where it's like, he's like, no, I can't get involved, and R2's like, dude.
Oh, man,
I love that his first line was, watch your language, Sacred Island.
That whole thing about fucking R2.
Which means he probably was like, this shitty fucking island.
Yeah. You're stuck here on this fucking piece of shit island.
You left us for this fuckhole island?
Yeah.
What the fuck?
I want to read the novel now so we can see what he said
it's so frustrating to me because R2...
What if R2 was going to be like, why were you going to lightsaber that fucking kid?
That's fucked up, dude.
Yeah, R2's like...
You started this fucking
that's
shit.
That's messed up. I saw some crazy shit, man. Fucking can't ever get that back. You know, that's what that... Looking at R2 and BB-8 really makes me... Not even 3PO, because 3PO kind of has the same sort of behaviors. You know, like, he kind of has the same sort of neuroses.
He's the only one who's gotten his memory erased, like, consistently wiped.
But, like, BB-8 and R2-D2 really make me wish that somebody would give me some hard facts. And I know that I'm being a stupid fandom menace, but, like, I would love some hard, researched essays on the intelligence of droids. Because R2, like, the way that R2 curses, like, who programmed him to curse?
I know, right?
Who gave him the ability to say, fuck that, and fuck this?
How did he get this personality?
Well, exactly. Like, someone gave this to him, or did he learn it? Is he smart enough to learn?
Who in the Star Wars universe invented a droid language for droids to speak, wherein droids had curse words?
Yeah, and also, here's my other thing.
For droids to have curse words?
Are droids just basically understood by everybody?
No.
Because
they're not, because not everybody
Not
understands
everyone understands them. But
Luke understands R2, because they spend so much time together.
Finn understands BB-8.
Does Rey does too?
Well, some
Rey
people speak droid. Yeah.
No, Rey does. Remember, she had a whole conversation with him.
Yeah.
Rey does.
But it's like,
she understands Chewie.
She does. Yeah. But that makes sense because she lives in Nima Outpost.
Yeah.
So she's been so... But it's kind of like one of those things where, like...
Is she just
a polyglot that she just knows a lot of different languages?
Yeah, maybe.
Like, how do you learn droid language? Is there a class you take? Or do you just kind of, like, pick it up? But it's weird, right?
How could you possibly just pick it up and
exactly.
speak English?
That's what I'm saying.
If you have the Force...
Well, like, but... They explain that with his relationship with Luke, though. When R2 talks to him in the X-Wing, it's translated. There's a little... You see it on the screen.
You see it on the screen.
No, but in A New Hope, doesn't he talk to R2?
No, he talks to R2. He always talks to R2. He understands R2. But that's also what's strange, is that R2 speaks in beeps and people understand him, and so does BB-8. But 3PO... I mean, well, 3PO is a human relation cyborg, so he speaks, like, 11,000 different languages or whatever. He speaks in their common...
Over 3 million, I think.
3 million, whatever. He speaks in common language, right?
Yeah.
So it's like, weird, like... I'm sorry, that's one of those things. See, but this is the thing. I'm going way too much into this, and it's fascinating for me and fun. Yeah. But that's the thing. It's fascinating and fun for me. I'm not going to get angry because there isn't a droid translation book fucking written like the Silmarillion. I don't need that. It's just something fun to contemplate. And that's part of the problem with this whole fandom wank bullshit, because they become enraged that these are not things that are, like, sitting in a fucking book somewhere for them to read. Totally. Anyway.
So what's your favorite moment?
No, did you do all your five things?
No, I did one.
Oh,
we just went off on it.
We all go on one? Okay.
Yeah.
Well, like, is it in order of the most famous?
No, just whatever.
Just whatever? Well, I guess definitely one of my favorite moments, I'm going to leap into yours, was Luke and the sacrifice that he made for Rey and Leia and the Resistance, and I think also for Ben. I sit there and I've seen a lot of, you know, articles talking about how this is so out of character for Luke, and those people, I feel, are the people that I talk about when they're like, you're not paying attention to the art that you're processing, dude. Like,
they're
you're not seeing the you're not watching the same films that I'm watching, because he's always had the capacity for failure and anger and fear, always. And so much of what happened in his life has been thrust upon him.
Yeah.
He wasn't going to go to anywhere. His parent, his uncle, and his aunt were brutally murdered.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? If they were fine, Luke was not leaving fucking Tatooine.
He wanted to, though. He wanted to go to the academy.
And but would he have...
But would he have gone with Obi-Wan?
But,
no.
But
no, he
that's
Obi-Wan.
What I'm saying. I'm
he
saying he wouldn't have
Jedi
come with this
stuff.
Old man who's like, hey, I got a weird secret for you. You're part of a magic clan of
weird wizards
who have laser swords, who like, he would never have gone with him. He would have gone to the academy or complained enough that they sent him because he's a whiny baby, just like his father before him and his fucking nephew. And his fucking I'm sure you are!
So your favorite moment is that Luke left Tantum?
No.
Oh, that Luke came back and fought Kylo Ren?
Luke fought Kylo Ren, and I'm talking about it.
Sorry.
Okay.
Yeah.
God damn it, man.
What are you talking about fucking tangent? You
didn't hear my tangent?
I understood your tangent, but I'm trying to get you back to Last Jedi, Coño.
No, this is going to be a four-hour podcast. Just like it was a two-and-a-half.
Really gonna be
this is going to be a long podcast. You may have to do a two-parter. You need to fuck off. We've been waiting for this for fucking forever, and we're going to do this right. Anyway, to get back to his characterization, Luke always had the capacity for fear, for anger. He almost killed his father in a moment of rage when he threatened his sister and he threatened everything. So the idea that Luke in this movie wouldn't be that person 30 years down the line, perhaps even more amplified, is stupid and ridiculous.
Yeah.
Luke, and I love some of the essays that have come out defending his behavior, because I'm sorry, Luke faced a moment of real, tangible fear. And I might get emotional talking about this, because I've been very emotional about it. Like, obviously, you know, Leia and Han have their own failings in terms of Ben.
Mm-hmm.
But he was the nail in the coffin. You know? Like, that's fucked up. Like, I don't really get people that just look at Kylo and think of him as this very black and white person and not see the pain that he's in. Like, I think it's very sad. I think it's just like Anakin. It's fucking sad.
He fucked
Anakin
up.
Makes me so sad. People look at Darth Vader all I think about is how fucking sad it is. It's sad what happened to him. His mother was taken away from him. He never got anybody that truly understood and loved him. And then he had all this anger and no one processed it. And it's the same thing that happened with Ben. And it's horrible for this family that, like, they can't escape these sins that keep coming back.
Yeah.
And there's only been one guy that's been able to do it. And he didn't even do it that well because he fucking tried and then he failed again. And then he made a problem. And it's just so fucked up. And so, like,
that's like the whole story of evil in the Star Wars galaxy is kids that every adult in their lives completely fucking failed.
They become orphans.
And they become Darth Vader.
Exactly.
And they become Kylo Ren.
Like, they become orphans in all the ways that matter. They become orphans. Yes, parents may physically be alive, but that doesn't mean anything. And it's so sad. And so it's like,
it's like Harry Potter if no one had come for him when he was 11.
Exactly. That's what this is. And then all of a sudden, everyone just wants to look at them and go, you're horrible and we should murder you, you know? And yes, I get it. They're murdering people.
Totally.
They're not nice. They've got laser swords and they're sticking them in people's faces. But like at the same time, it's like, how do you not feel the tragedy of it. Like, yeah, I just, you know, yeah. Yeah, like, and I just, plus, and so it's kind of like that. So
I think it makes people uncomfortable to identify
to really
that
think
way
about it like that. People how horribly like that. Tragic this is.
How this, how easy it is for this to happen.
Exactly.
In the real world.
Exactly. Like, yes, Star Wars is a fairy tale. So, like, it's Kylo Ren. It's archetypes. So Kylo Ren will get, he's not going to space prison, guys.
Yeah, right.
Like, they're not gonna have a trial here. This isn't gonna be Law and Jedi Order. Like, it's not gonna work out like that.
Right.
It's gonna be, he either lives and he's redeemed or he dies. Well, three ways. He dies and he's redeemed, he lives right. and he's redeemed, or he just fucking dies. Those are the three ways his life is going right now.
Right.
That's it. There are no space prisons. There are no, you know, some people think, oh, maybe he'll be ostracized. That technically is a death. When someone tells you, go across the galaxy and leave everybody alone forever and go live on your own in a fuck off island, that's a death.
Carbonate? Like his death?
Yeah.
Oh, shit! No! That would be, no. That would be, I'd kill myself. I'm killing myself. I'm telling you right now. You heard it here first. It's 2018, January 9th.
That would be,
I would kill myself.
That would be fucking
the only prison we
can
put
tragedy.
Kylo Ren in is carbonite.
That would be worse than him dying. That would be worse than him dying.
God,
would be to freeze him in fucking carbonite. Leia better be dead
can
for
that. Can you imagine the John Williams music for that scene?
I think John Williams would just give up and start crying on the piano, like, I don't like this. The horn section.
The amazing thing, too, I really dig about Luke's ultimate fight with Kylo Ren is that he, like, is more in line with his Return of the Jedi self. Like, his ultimate redemptive act in Return of the Jedi is his power to forgive his father. And all he wants to do to Kylo Ren is apologize. And say, I'm sorry, Ben.
That, yeah, I'm going into,
you know,
exactly, so it's like,
you.
It's like, that's
you
the
know?
Thing.
I
the,
think that has a lot to do with his, the way that he responds that, I'm sure
yes.
you are.
Yeah.
But it gets to
him,
and he doesn't want it to.
Exactly.
Forgiveness is going
to
be an important
huge
component
theme
of
this
movies.
Story.
Oh, yeah.
I think that forgiveness is a huge theme of these stories. We've already mm-hmm. seen it. Han
yeah.
and Leia forgive each other for leaving each other.
Mm-hmm.
They and Han forgives Kylo for becoming Kylo, and that's, you know, killing his dad fucking hurts him. But I think that if his dad had come to him and been like, you're a fucking shithead, and you should never have done this, he would have had a lot less problems sticking a saber into his father's
right.
heart. But the fact that his father came to him and said, I'm sorry, and come home, and we love you,
mm-hmm.
and then put
mm-hmm.
his, like, that broke him. You,
mm-hmm.
when you rewatch The Force Awakens, you can see the moment his face, like, what have I done? Like, it's horrible. And so it's like, but forgiveness is part of Kylo's journey. And I think it's really important for Luke to forgive him. So that moment that he not only comes, Luke does everything that he should have done. I'm sorry, that choice that he made was perfection. To say, I have to help Leia, I have to help the Resistance, I have to help Rey, but I also have to let Ben know.
Plus,
that this, you know, that this is, you know, I'm sorry. And even if this is it and it's too late for him, I will not have died without him knowing that I regret everything that I did.
Yeah.
And so it's like that fucks him up. Kylo ends this movie. He's not like standing there like, yeah, I did it. I'm the winner of stuff. Like, we'll get him next time, fellow First Order. He's
on
his knees.
Yeah.
He is crying.
Plus,
he's fucking emotional. He's destroyed. And like, and also you see how afraid of Luke he is.
Mm.
Nobody tells 520 fucking
ATACs
to fire on one dude. I don't care how force powerful he is.
Right.
If you're not scared shitless of this
mm-hmm.
guy, like. And so it's just like,
and that is that great little moment where he's like,
more! Yeah, like,
and he force pushes the firing button further, and the guy at the control like looks back at him.
That's what that was.
Yeah, he pushes
it
forward. He's giving
he's
it more
it
juice.
More, yeah, and then
he's
Hux
like,
is the one that.
And the guy
like,
looks back at him like, dude, what the fuck?
Yeah, like, and it's like such. I'm sorry, like everything Luke did was so important, and like. Luke did everything he was supposed to do, became
and,
a hero, and he did this, and it's such an emotional sacrifice.
He,
like
he found a way to help the resistance where they found a way to help themselves. Like, you know, he didn't have to come in there and say, do this, do that. So no one is still...
There's not a more beautiful pacifist message than him force projecting himself across the universe so that his sister doesn't have to watch him kill her son.
Right.
Okay?
Or the other way around.
Or the other way around. Doesn't have to watch her family kill each other.
Yeah.
She definitely he told her. Like, she knew, he told her. I have theories that, like, he told her to keep the Force dice projected so that he would see them. Because, like, there's a moment when I watched it the fifth time, I saw this kind of tiny, almost imperceptible nod.
Yeah, he does a little,
He holds her hand, and she kind of goes like this, and she nods. And I think that she was the one projecting the Force dice for fucking Ben. And especially that moment when he tells her no one's ever really gone. Oh. He gave her hope. Maybe he told her in her mind, you know, Rey tried to save him. Rey saw conflict in him. I don't know whatever happened between them, what passed. But something passed between them. And you don't notice it the first couple times you see it. But
it's there.
But it's absolutely there. Yeah. And it's kind of like, yeah, like, he came and he did so much. And so when he...
Plus, we only ever see the Force dice in when Leia puts it in her hand. Yeah. Like, it's not like you see it and then it dangles and it's in her hand.
No, it's, it's only when it's in her hand and then when it's in Kylo's hand and on the floor. Like, and so it's like he did the most heroic thing he could do. And it was beautiful and it was wonderful. And so when he goes out with peace and purpose, you understand what that means. And I think that, like, I think this is fucking Mark Hamill's best performance, one of his best things I've ever seen him do.
Well, it's so interesting, too, to look back at, just even looking back at the moment when Kylo kills Han Solo, like, it's so clearly, like, this is, it's, you know, it's one of those things that I'm sure that, like, every Sith probably has gone through. Mm-hmm. This one moment of, like, solidifying your... darkness. Connection to the darkness. And it was, I feel like it was that, and it was also, he was wanting to prove something to Snoke, too.
Yeah.
But there's always that moment, like, people get on Episode 3's case a lot about how sudden it was for Anakin, that he just all of a sudden cuts off Mace Windu's arm.
But it wasn't sudden.
I don't think it was.
No, it wasn't sudden at all. The darkness had been building in him
and
for years.
And what's the last thing he says before he does that to Mace Windu? He says, I need him. Yeah. He doesn't say, don't kill him. It's against the Jedi. Like, he says all that for shit first. But the real reason comes out when he's right about to kill him. He says, I need him. To save Padme.
Yes.
And that's why he does it. It's all about...
It's all about saving Padme. It's all about love. And it's like...
And he, even after he does it, he's like, what have I done?
Yeah.
And like, then at that point, he's fucked. Like, he doesn't have anything...
At that point, he has to go down the path.
Hypothetically, Palpatine was, like, fainting the whole time. Like, Palpatine wasn't showing his true power.
Right. I mean, I think Palpatine
gave himself over so that...
At the point when Anakin comes in, he's already on the floor, but he probably could have gotten out of that position on the floor. But when he sees Anakin, he's like, whoa, he's trying to kill me. He's trying to assassinate me. To play on his, totally.
Yeah, I really do. I love
But it definitely is all about that he needs him. He needs him to save Padme.
Absolutely. Absolutely, yeah. Like
and he regrets it immediately, but then at that point it's too late. He's like, I have no other choice.
And it's the ultimate thing that the failing of the Jedi, because they're so dogmatic and obsessed with this rigid structure of their religion, because it is their religion.
Yeah,
it's
it
not
is.
The faith, it's their religion, that they're like, you can't have any connections, you can't love anybody.
Right.
And it's like, so then everything that happens with Padme is this like, terrible whirlwind of controversy, instead of just like embracing change and embracing the ability to be adaptive and be like, okay, you know, this guy really needs something. He needs somebody. But that's the problem. They never saw he needed anybody, because if they had, they would never have taken his mother away from him.
The code that the Jedi live by, with this no attachments to people, It made what happened. Yes, yeah. It made this inevitable.
Yeah, exactly.
It was inevitable that at some point some really powerful Jedi is going to fall in love with somebody. It just happens to be the fucking chosen one, so it's even worse.
Exactly.
So,
but
I've been thinking about it, and it's got to be like there's eventually somewhere in some book or something. There's got to be some reason why the Jedi, like, specifically, like, kept on pulling mothers away from their children.
Right.
That's the other thing, too, like, is you sit there and you look at them, like, how are you like any different? Always, how are you different from the Empire? How are you different? Exactly.
It's
how are you? How are you different from the Empire? Right. You're taking children away from their families, exactly. You know? And it's specifically, like, mothers, because there are, you know, there are female Jedi, but the majority of the Jedi are men. And, I mean, that could just be the filming cultural dynamics of our modern world into the film, but at the same time, it sends a clear image of these, and like almost everyone in the Jedi Council, I think they're all men.
No, I don't think there's a woman.
I don't think there was a woman in the Jedi Council.
No, there's a couple women.
There was a couple women?
Yeah, they're just made of aliens and stuff, but there's some women.
Okay, well, but like the majority of them
but
were
there,
men. There was a female Yoda. Wasn't there like a one female
Yaddle,
Yoda?
And there's some female, but they look like just aliens. They don't have any, like,
Hillary Clinton-style Jedi.
And I guess at the end of the day, they prescribe to the patriarchal idea of no attachments.
Yeah.
And, you know what I mean? They subscribe to that.
It's
so,
it's a very Buddhist kind of, which is a lot of what it's based on, what the Force is based on, the Taoism and Buddhism.
And I mean, it is very Buddhist, but then the problem with that is that that's not always going to work for him.
It's
things become dangerous when they become dogmatic. You know, everyone looks at Buddhists.
A Buddhist will tell you, like my kind of Buddhist, at least, what I would call a good Buddhist would tell you that the non-attachment thing, you have to not be attached to anything, including non-attachment. So there's that. There's like, even that is an attachment. Being attached. Being so attached to non-attachment, to have it be a dogma,
being attached to rigidity,
attachment.
It's true. Like, it's just the
Jedi. So when Anakin falls in love, be like, you know, talk to him about relationships and love.
That's
and all that,
and that's
the feelings.
That's the biggest problem,
you know?
Is that nobody in this fucking universe seems to be able to have fucking conversations about their goddamn emotions.
Yeah.
Like, you need therapy. What is the matter with all of you? Like, you can't talk to your son? Like, did you talk to your son about the fact that there was a dark, evil force speaking in his ear when he went to bed at night?
Seriously.
I mean, fucking hell, dude.
Hey,
like,
Boba Fett's an orphan, too.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Holy shit.
You know, orphans.
What was your favorite moment?
One of my favorite moments. Your first, we're all still on one.
Favorite moments or favorite, like,
what, your first favorite moment?
A favorite moment.
Things about the...
A positive
one
last
moment.
Jedi.
A moment, okay.
We're going
favorite
the round with
moments.
5 moments, I think. It's gonna take us 4 hours to do that.
I kind of don't want to, like, go straight to my favorite... like my number one, but that's like the first thing that's coming to my head, I think. Although maybe something better will come. But I think my favorite, just like visceral filmmaking and storytelling moment of The Last Jedi was Holdo sacrificing herself. That was such a powerful, and the way that it was done was so good. And like, I remember when I saw it the first time, I remember there's a moment where she looks out the window and sees that all the ships are getting blown up, and then she goes to the chair, and I'm like, oh shit, what's she gonna do? And then one of the Empire officers said, they're going into light speed. I was like, holy shit, she's about to tear through this ship. And the moment with the silence and everything, oh, God,
the beautiful cinematic moment,
so well
done. All the sound totally washed out of the theater.
Yeah,
so
so funny too, because maybe it was you that was saying that people complained.
Yeah, there was
the sound cut out.
There's apparently some theaters they had to post like a warning to people, warning them that
that's so funny.
And
that
a portion of the film there is.
I can't imagine thinking that wasn't on purpose. I can't imagine. Well,
it comes back.
Like, yeah, it comes back, like, really, what, like...
Like, it, like, mixed like, it's a back rumble, in.
And,
yeah,
like,
yeah.
Yeah, like, I can't imagine people thinking people that was not on purpose. That's so people interesting. People are
stupid. The other thing I heard is supposedly at the L.A. premiere of The Last Jedi, when Luke fades away, that someone in the audience was like, did he teleport? Like, they didn't register. Yeah. Again.
Oh, man. That's so funny, too, because he's clearly, he's younger. Like, you think he just made himself younger to fight Kylo Ren?
No, he puts them just for men on. He got a haircut. The fish maiden's like, yeah, Mordita! Fucking cutting his hair, like, you know, just guys, come on.
You need to see her.
I don't think they like me. Yeah, I can't imagine why.
Yeah, meanwhile, he blows up a whole fucking hut. I bet they loved him after that. Right? They're probably like, get off this fucking
dude. Well,
they meant the fade away on the rock when he dies.
Oh, okay.
That they thought that
he
was
did
him.
Not teleport.
Oh, that he teleported?
Yeah. And it's kind of
like,
that's
not a thing the Jedi have ever done.
Well, the Jedi can force project across the universe.
Do you remember? That's different, and that has basis.
Obviously,
in,
it's different.
That has basis in the potential powers because they can become Force ghosts. So technically, you can become a Force ghost.
And go beyond
could,
death, why couldn't
could
we go
you
across
not,
the
yeah,
galaxy?
Yeah, exactly, why couldn't you go across the galaxy? And
I wonder if that's
bonds,
what that was.
I'm sorry, Force
I
bonds.
I wonder if what, that's what that was, if that was a Force ghost, and he was, like, in between life and death.
Maybe, that's
doing
probably,
that.
Probably.
And then that's why he died, because, like, you can't just come back for good.
Exactly.
That's, he pushed the limits. So.
And obviously, and it also, you know, it was really a brilliant thing to do, too, because it actually showed you also the juxtaposition between what the force bond between Kylo and Rey was and what a force projection is.
Yeah.
Because Kylo tells her at the beginning, he says,
you
can't
see
your surroundings. I know, and he's like, you can't, and he's like, you're not doing this, the
effort
alone
would
kill
you.
And so it's like, he knows that force projection is possible, but it's fucking hard and it drains a lot out of the person. They have to be very powerful. Mm-hmm. Second, in the Force bond, they have the ability to physically feel each other. You know what I mean? Like, they can touch and they can feel each other. That's not something that Luke could ever do in the Force projection.
Yeah.
That's why he had to evade him until it was...
That's not something we've ever
seen
anybody do.
Except in Knights of... in Battlefront or Knights of the Old Republic, Ravan and Bastila Ray, they do it.
Oh, really?
And they're actually a canonical couple of a Sith and a Jedi who fall in love.
Oh, really?
Kaboom!
And then she fights with a two-sided lightsaber.
Yeah.
Oh, really?
Ha-ha! Kaboom! That's why a lot of people think, oh, are they like Darth Ravon and Bastila Ray? Like, they're very similar in that idea.
That's
but,
so
like,
interesting.
Yeah, isn't that interesting? But they have a Force bond. And Force bonds are, can they? There are things they've talked about and other things that are a Force bond. But yeah, but never, we've never seen it, like,
never
in,
seen one
in,
a movie. In
a movie. And so this, yeah, it's like, but I like that because it showed you the, not only did it serve to show Luke, but it served to show the differences, just how special what happened between Kylo and Rey really was. Because
especially
it's
not
a
when
common
you see,
thing.
When, especially the moment when you see that it's still there after Snoke
after
is dead.
After Snoke is dead.
Unless he's lying about bridging their minds, and they were bridged already.
Well,
like he alerted them,
I think that it was very important the way Snoke worded that sentence. He said,
I bridged your minds.
But he didn't say it was I who created the Force bond.
Created the connection.
He just said bridged. They already had it. It was already
he
there.
He may have reached out into the Force and found their
bond
that already existed.
Because obviously,
activated it,
in another mythology that I've read about the Force bond, it tends to be something that like a Jedi, a master and a Jedi, an apprentice, can have to work on figuring out. So, obviously, you have to be actively thinking about it. So, Rey and Kylo Ren, at this moment, when they start fucking episode 8, they're not like, yeah, I want to talk to that guy. Like, no, they're like, fuck you, you know?
But they're thinking about each other.
They're thinking about each other, but in a very, like...
Well, Rey is more fuck you. I think Kylo maybe
not so much. Kylo's kind of like... Kyle's like, this stupid girl, where'd she go?
Stupid girl with her beautiful hair!
Her fucking face! She was really pretty when she lit that lightsaber.
Your sweat smells like cinnamon.
I hate you so much.
You are a perfect physical specimen.
Just because you are making me very sexually confused does not mean that I'm going to do what you say
For all the Star Wars nerds that have never seen the Pitch Perfect movies.
Oh my god.
That's what we're quoting right now.
Yeah, exactly.
Did, so you thought that, like, Holdo's storyline, like, them kind of teasing her
liked,
to be a dick.
Well, I just
then,
really like that.
Oh, I love
that. Like,
yeah.
Twisting it, that pose.
I really like that moment.
I will say
there's
this
a part
this
of
this
me...
is one of my favorite moments too. I think Holdo, so I can include this as my number two, just so I can
Whoa.
Piggyback on this. Definitely.
But yeah, no. One of the things, well, there's still one. Like I get, I totally get, and I agree with all the shit that Poe Dameron is getting about this toxic masculinity and everything.
Mm-hmm.
And that's done on purpose. Like,
mm-hmm.
that's a, you know, you're supposed to be angry at him at the end of this movie. But also, like, there's still a part of me that wonders, why couldn't she tell anyone about this plan that
well,
she had?
Well, I'm thinking one
yeah.
reason.
Yeah.
One reason is,
I think
one reason
is probably
well,
that
you,
he's such a trigger-happy flyboy.
No.
That he's not
yeah.
going to like the plan or
That's
something.
What I
he's
going
to do
okay.
something crazy, but she did anyway.
Yeah.
Hypothetically, that B, there's now hyperspace tracking on the board. And hypothetically, you still don't know, as far as the resistance goes, how the fuck their hyperspace track.
Yeah,
track.
Maybe.
She doesn't know,
yeah.
she doesn't
so
know these people. She doesn't know this crew.
She doesn't
she's
know this crew.
Yeah.
Trust.
It's possible
so she's just
more
keeping
than
it
from
her
yeah.
keeping it close to the vest,
I actually
yeah.
think that's what it what,
yeah.
what
okay.
it really is. It's about her keeping it close to the leadership.
Then also
because
three, I think also maybe it's her arrogance getting the best of her, where she feels that Poe put them in this situation by committing too much of their forces.
I don't even think that's fucking arrogant.
Against her will.
Like,
yeah,
I think
no, but,
she...
no, but she's kind of, like, you know, going out of her way to not communicate because she's angry at him.
There are some people
you
who
know?
Think that he really did nothing to deserve Leia deferring to his authority at the end of the movie. And it's kind of like...
Yeah.
I mean, I guess he figured out, oh, sometimes you gotta know when to hold them, when know when to fold them, but, like... At the same time, it's like, you got a lot of people killed, bro.
Yeah.
Like, you
yeah,
did a
but,
lot of damage.
Yeah, but everyone else in there, in that room, was just sitting there like, oh my god, Luke's here to save us.
Yeah.
Poe was the only one who's like,
no,
how the
that...
fuck does asshole get in here?
Yeah,
right.
It's true.
We
how
have to get the fuck
here?
Out.
He's doing this
everyone
for a
else
reason.
Is just like, oh.
No, and that was important. And that was important.
And
I
Finn,
think that
like,
was,
Finn,
yeah.
Finn has a totally different, he's like, we need to help him. And Poe's like, no, hold on, we need to think about this for a sec. Which is
Why
such a switch.
Yeah.
It's such a switch from when they're telling Poe their plan. He's
yeah.
like, okay, so we blow it up.
Yeah.
No, and this
no,
time, Poe's like, no, hold on, we need to think about this
exactly,
for a
Exactly, like he...
Why is
in
he
that way,
this?
He learned. In that way, he learned to think before
what
he
is the big
acted.
Picture?
But I think at the moment Holdo shuts him out, she has a very good reason
yeah.
to shut him out. He is an impulsive idiot.
Yeah, totally.
Like, he
Plus,
got people
it
killed.
Could be a prejudice, too, in that.
And the worst part is he didn't see that he did anything wrong. That's
right.
the thing. She tells him to get his head out of his cockpit. He doesn't fucking think anything went wrong. He thinks,
yeah.
well, we did the right
we
thing.
We blew up
like,
a dreadnought, so
Plus,
what's the problem?
Hypothetically, they're fleet killers. Even though we don't have a fleet.
They are. And, like, you know, the resistance is down to so few people at this point that those people that they lost on the mission
yeah.
are way more important than taking down that dreadnought.
Possibly. the other thing is, too, maybe it's not just toxic masculinity. Maybe it's toxic femininity. Because, you know,
what?
Holdo is from under Leia. So maybe Holdo, because she's from this...
Oh,
you know,
yeah.
matriarchal
oh,
chain
God.
Of command.
Okay.
She doesn't respect men's
okay,
decision
fanboy.
Making.
Okay,
fanboy.
All right, thanks, fanboy. Thank
right?
you. Thank you, fanboy. Thank you. Thank you for that. From the corners of 4chan. Thank you.
Toxic femininity.
Oh,
yeah.
my God.
Oh,
yes.
Is that like an InfoWars term you saw?
Yeah, right.
Yeah.
I just invented
toxic
it.
Those toxic females.
I just pulled it out of my ass. Hello.
There sound like
yes.
it.
Yes.
No, yeah,
put
I love. Put it right back up there.
Oh.
No, yeah, Holdo was great. I love that moment.
Yeah.
I think that was such a. It just it was a great one of my favorite moments in the movie, just because it was so cool and it was like one of those parts of this movie that gives you something that we know exists in the Star Wars universe, but we've never seen before. Like them use it that way,
right.
and that's what I really loved about this movie: the way that Ryan takes things that we're oh so familiar with, and just subverts them just a little bit or a lot of bit, and like really makes you think about them or makes you look at them in a new and awesome way. Like,
yeah, that's something that, you know, they never address. That's such a, like, that's, that would totally be a thing.
It makes you wonder, where you travel in hyperspace. It makes you wonder why there aren't more hyperspace kamikazes.
Absolutely. Or accidents, like, to be able to chart that course over, like,
the
span of galaxies.
Because she fucking split.
Well,
she fucking split that,
she did
15 ships.
Yeah, they
all. No, but the reason why it's so many ships is because she's a
big pieces.
Cruiser.
No, it's the pieces.
No, but
it's got to be the
pieces. But she's in a cruiser.
Yeah.
Like, if the Millennium Falcon did that, it would not...
No,
like,
it would not
take out 15 Star Destroyers.
Yeah, no, totally.
You know?
But I'm saying...
Maybe
but
15.
The pieces of the ships at light speed just cut through... Like, they go in all directions, as fast, but really fast.
Yeah.
And that's why it just, like, it breaks, like,
plus
15
they,
ships
they
all at
they
set once.
Up in the first action sequence that, like, in space, when one ship blows up and starts coming apart...
It can...
Yeah.
It's gonna hit everything around it. Like, there's no control
happen.
And explosion.
And that
in
actually
space.
Is interesting because that actually kind of is in line with the physics of space. Because
right, absolutely.
You can't control the explosion.
No, because once you start throwing something in one direction, in terms of the gravity, in terms of the vacuum of space, it keeps going at the same speed. Like,
mm-hmm.
you know what I mean? Like,
mm-hmm.
there is no...
Have you seen the movie Gravity?
There's
yes.
There's no friction to slow it down.
Where the satellite explodes.
Yeah.
And they know, they have to, like, be, there's, like, 2 hours
they
that they have
come
before the debris
orbit.
Gets there. But it's going, because there's no resistance in space, it's going super, it's, like, super fucking sonic speeds.
Yeah.
That one guy gets, a big hole in
yeah.
his fucking face from something going straight
yeah.
through his head.
Yeah.
So,
no,
yeah.
and it's cool, but yeah, because so it's kind of into the physics of that, the fact that, yeah, it just keeps going.
Yeah.
You know, which, and so, yeah, it was nice to see that, like, that if a fucking thing flew, it would hit something, and then it would
hit
something
else,
and it would ping pong, and, you know, whatever. But, like,
especially
I don't like
for those bombers, because they're so clunky,
yeah,
I feel
exactly.
like, because they're heavy.
I also really loved... I love to see the kind of tiny details that work in these movies, like the fact that obviously the First Order is really well financed.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of that seems to actually come, well, one, from the fact that they're ruthless and they'll fucking take over planets and be like, we're taking all of your shit now.
All your natural resources.
But also, too, I think that General Hux, him and his father are very well-to-do military
mm-hmm.
officers. Like, it's a very, like, thing in their family, so he kind of has this, you know, this very neat organ, and like, but I love to see that, how like the First Order has all this money and all these resources simply because they're ruthless enough to be like, fuck you, I'm taking your shit, and the Resistance is making do with these bombers that are so old and clunky. You know,
mm-hmm.
there's got to be better bombers, faster bombers,
yeah, totally.
More like, you know, put together things, and they're like things falling apart. And it's like, I love to see that juxtaposition because it really is so much about access to resources based on what they're willing to.
You know what I just realized
to,
also?
Like, do,
those
you know,
bombers are contingent on gravity.
Yeah.
Because they're just, the bombs are just hanging there.
They
and
have
they
electromagnets.
Them. They have to be over.
Well, they have magnets.
No, they
have
electromagnets, yes.
So, like, I think when that light comes on, the that's getting armed.
No,
they're
electromagnets. They're electromagnets. That's why they have to be over the payload so like that. Because they need the electromagnets to work to suck
to
down
suck
the bombs.
Down.
Which is
yeah.
also what happened to sort of, like, Boba or Jango Fett's bombs in Attack of the Clones.
Yeah.
That they were, like, magnetized and sonic
bombs. Okay. Second favorite thing.
Second. Your second favorite thing is...
I'm on my third.
Yeah. Boom, boom.
I'm winning the race now. Okay.
My second favorite thing would have to be Kylo Ren freaking kneeling before Snoke getting the throne room. Like, I loved how the movie wasn't afraid to, like, lay out, like, geography in, like, a room and, like, you know, because if the first time we ever saw the throne room was, like, that first scene where Rey gets taken to the throne room.
Oh, yeah.
Like, that would have been, like, so much to process. But the fact that we get, like, a glimpse of what it's like for, like, Kylo Ren and Hux with, like, Snoke kind of playing them both against each other.
Right.
To get what he wants. And then getting, like, a chance to see, like, a pure moment of, like, how Snoke manipulates Kylo Ren
yeah.
to get what he wants, and then him just being like
and abuses him,
calling him heir apparent to Vader, and, like,
and he abuses him. He's such an abusive relationship. It's interesting because some people even on like Tumblr, it's weird. Some people on Tumblr even read it as an almost like a sexual abuse. Like,
oh really?
Yeah, I don't know. Some people on Tumblr like they kind of read almost like a that he might be. Like, he has the apparent attitude of, like, an abuse victim. You yeah. know what I mean? Well, he does, but, like, possibly sexual abuse victim, the way right. that he behaves and the way that he kind of, like, reacts to things and, you know, holds it. I mean, I don't know if that holds water. It's a Disney movie. I don't think they're yeah, going to talk about anything fucking... Right. But, like, at the same time...
I don't think they're going to make Bad Touch Kylo Ren figures.
Stop.
Like, no, with Bad Touch. No, don't touch that. Stop.
It's like it's just it's but I understand what they're saying, like it if the fact that we're talking about that we know these things from like Aftermath, there's a book, The Aftermath of the Empire, that talks about Leia feeling a dark presence in when her son is in her womb.
Oh,
right? And there was a deleted scene in The Force Awakens where Rey was gonna see Snoke standing over a little boy. Okay.
Oh my god.
And that they never filmed. I guess they couldn't figure out how to film it or whatever. Or no, I guess they were afraid. No, they were probably afraid that maybe it just wouldn't hit an emotional beat or I don't know, whatever. But and then also, yeah, and we know that Leia knows Snoke was the one. Kylo has been dealing with Snoke his whole fucking life.
Plus,
okay? That if that isn't a classic case of child abuse, I don't know what is. So it's like, and then, yeah, the way that he talks about him without talking about him, that whole rabid curse speech, that's not about Hux. That's about Kylo Ren.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? It's a little bit about Hux, but it's mostly about Kylo Ren. He's calling him a rabid cur. He's calling him a tool. You know what I mean? And then that's one of the reasons why the moment when Han Solo tells him, you know that Snoke is just using you for your power, the minute he gets what he wants, he'll crush you. That, like, you see Kylo react to that because he knows that. Like, he knows that's the game, but it's just like...
Every Sith apprentice knows that. Vader totally knew that about Palpatine from the beginning.
But the problem,
When Padme comes to him about it, he's like, I'm more powerful than him. Yeah. I can overthrow him. That's already
in
their
mind.
They just
but
have
the,
to bide
but
their
the problem
time
is,
and shit.
Unlike Anakin or unlike, you know, everyone else who's dealt with this, like, Kylo kind of, like, the light part of him is in pain over it. Because
right.
he's like, I've chosen this side, and this side's going to get me what I want, I swear. But it also kind of really fucking sucks, and I don't really like it that much.
Well,
like,
he's also looking for what do I need to
do to
kill that
light
to stop feeling
like I could,
these
and then,
feelings.
Yeah, exactly.
And he thinks that killing Han Solo is going to do it. But
and
it does
Snoke
the opposite.
And Snoke convinces him that it will.
But it does the opposite.
Yeah, and definitely Kylo totally thinks about the idea that he could take over from Snoke and kill Snoke. Not the first time. Episode 8 isn't the first time he thinks about it.
Right.
It's just that I think that, you know, in a way, he was kind of riding the train for a while.
Right.
You know, like,
yeah.
he was like, I'm
That's
not...
That's what all the Sith apprentices
like, he's,
do.
And he's not
they
a,
just buy their
He's
time.
Not a Sith, but yeah, in that way, he behaves
that's
what, Sith-like.
That's what Sidious was doing to Plagueis.
Yeah.
He was just
waiting
to kill him
yeah.
in his sleep. If you remember that he says he was killed in his sleep by his apprentice,
mm-hmm.
and you don't know, he does it. It's only alluded to in the movie, but in the book, Darth Plagueis, it's actually no. He kills him.
Yeah,
he's his.
So
apprentice.
It's like Kylo kind of knows that, but at the same time, that's the problem is that the light that the conflict within him is kind of preventing him from really just being super hyper focused on that one goal, which
yeah.
is to take over a supreme leader,
right.
to take over the First Order, and to take over for Snoke, is what he's constantly in this state of, like, flux, of, like, emotional, you know, uncertainty and irrationality, because he doesn't, yeah, like, it's a mess. And then you take that, like, Snoke's been in his mind forever. And that's a thing, too, is it's such a significant idea that if Snoke has been influencing Ben since he was a little child, and he still has light in him to this
yeah.
point. Come the... Like,
yeah,
to
seriously.
Fucking not redeem him is like mean. I'm gonna just sound like a child. It's fucking mean.
It's
he's been like a he's been, you know, being influenced by Snoke for fucking ever. You know, that's the thing is that like
he's, and not only
people some people like to go, oh well, how old was he really when Snoke was starting in his mind? I'm like, obviously pretty fucking young, because Han and Leia say there was too much Vader in him. Right? He's like, one young, you know, there was too much Vader in him. We don't know how,
and that's,
they're obviously implying that even before they sent him to Luke, for a long time they knew.
And that's the thing too, not only is he being influenced by Snoke from a very young age, but that influence is, like, the people, his family, and the people around him see that influence, but they think it's him.
Yeah.
And that affects his relationship with all
everybody,
of them.
Exactly. And then you have like the fact that he has a father that doesn't know how to deal with it, so he's just like bleh. And then like Leia,
he's very Han about this.
I was talking to Satya about how there seems to be this kind of dynamic of Han wants him to be normal,
yeah,
and Leia and Luke want him to be a
Jedi, yeah,
and neither of them
ask him what
embraces
he wants. Yeah.
Well, or embraces him as a whole person,
yeah.
They want to pull him in this direction or that direction.
And like, looking at the glimpses, like, this is obviously all supplementary material, but it's there. Looking at the glimpses of, like, who Ben Solo is, not Kylo Ren, Ben Solo is, there's, like, the visual dictionary has, like, he has a calligraphy set. You actually see it in the movie. There's, like, a pen there with, like, a little bit of ink if you look on the side. He has a calligraphy set. He built his lightsaber from some ancient fucking book of, like, he's a nerd.
Yeah.
Like, he's a quiet, he was probably a very, like, studious, quiet child. Like, he probably really was very, he has a deep emotional core. He's always had it. And so it's kind of like, for people to disregard it and for Han to be the dad that's like, whatever, kid, go play space football
that
or
moment
whatever.
That moment when the person kicks Matt, the radar technician's wrench, and he's just like, hey, you just kicked my wrench!
Shirt face.
That was him in
high school. Kylo Ren. Like no, I was. It was funny because I was like headcanoning like what he was like in the Jedi Academy, and I'm like, first of all, he was like the only other person with a lightsaber. It was him and Luke because nobody else had a lightsaber.
Yeah.
Because the Knights of Ren. Yes, we do. The Knights of Ren didn't have lightsabers.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, we do. We saw it in the flashback. Not one
no,
of them was carrying a lightsaber.
He didn't have the suit when he fucking attacked them.
We don't know. He had Anakin's lightsaber.
We know
I
the Knights of Ren.
Don't know.
Yeah, I think this is what you're trying to say.
Well,
we know
half a second of the Knights of Ren.
We know that
they
the
don't
Knights
have
of,
lightsabers.
We don't know that for
yes,
sure.
Yes, we do. It's in the visual dictionary.
I don't
they
give
don't
a fuck
have
about
lightsabers.
The visual
okay,
dictionary.
Okay, but listen, we know that the Knights of Ren don't have lightsabers. The Knights of Ren may not be the only ones that were at the Jedi Academy with a lightsaber.
I'm pretty sure the only people. Okay, here's another supplementary material. J.J. Abrams said when the fight between him, Rey, and Finn in The Force Awakens, and this is on fucking film, so shut the fuck up. He says this is the first lightsaber duel he's ever been in. That's why he doesn't have this
Kylo Ren?
Yes.
Oh.
That's another thing to support when these fanboys are like, how did he get defeated by this woman who's never picked up?
Right.
He's never actually had to. So, I'm sorry, that implies to me, based off
Jedi.
All of this, there are, exactly.
There aren't any
where
Jedi.
Are they getting,
he's using that shit to kill
Even Rey, they left her at the end of episode 8 with a kyber crystal. They didn't go, well, she's gotta go on a journey to find a kyber crystal, because who the fuck even knows where the kyber crystals are anymore,
right,
bro?
Yeah,
it's
exactly.
Scattered across the universe. So they gave her
something to... Jedha before it got blown up.
Well, Jedha doesn't exist anymore.
Yeah, probably, yeah.
So, like, it doesn't. They
no,
blew it up.
Yeah.
So, like, the thing is that they gave her something to start with, because legit, there's, like, that's, like, it, bro. That's
yeah,
all
nothing,
I got.
There's nothing
so,
left of
so imagine, here is fucking, imagine this now.
Imagine.
Here's Ben Solo.
Imagine.
Here's Ben Solo starting Jedi Academy with his uncle. Legacy child of the fucking Senator Leia Organa, Princess of Alderaan. And his dad Han Solo, the war general. And his uncle Luke, the Jedi Master who defeated Darth Vader. And he's there with like 12 kids and him. They hated him. They hated him! And he's the only one with a fucking lightsaber. Totally he probably was just so... He probably was snobby. He probably was like, I got a lightsaber. No one else has a lightsaber. I was like, yeah, we know. Like, exactly. You know what I mean? Like, he probably was like a mess. I'm sorry. Like, this is not a situation that...
I don't think it's fair to say that he had the only lightsaber. Because we literally don't know that.
Okay, but from the clues that we are given by the Jedi
Academy with two lightsabers. That don't. If you're running a Jedi school, you need to
because put that maybe in the calligraphy maybe set. Eventually Luke would try to find Kyber crystals, but at the moment.
But you don't know that, so we don't know.
Obviously, that. Kylo found something because he built his fucking his saber.
What is your second favorite moment, Derek?
Why are you
did I not do second?
No, you haven't done your second.
No. Because you're talking about calligraphy sets. I want to talk about scenes that are in this film.
Okay. But it is in the film.
Not scenes that are in calligraphy sets.
It was in the film.
Okay.
I thought I did two already. No?
No, Holdo.
Holdo. There wasn't anything else.
You did one.
I thought I did another one.
I just need another thing.
Okay.
Next thing?
Well, I want to know how many I have left. I thought I did two already, so I'm just gonna do.
Then what's your second thing? What was the first thing?
I don't remember.
I think it was Luke's. You weren't to Luke?
No.
No, you started with Holdo. You're on your second
Holdo.
Thing.
Holdo.
Yes, that's what I said.
You're on your second thing.
A different thing.
Okay. No, I talked about Luke, and then I talked about Snoke, and then Danny talked about Holdo, and then Danny talked about Luke.
Okay, so my next thing. Is let's see. We're talking moments here.
You had a thing that you were gonna say was your favorite thing, but then you said I'm not gonna say that's my favorite thing because I don't want to blow my load too early.
No, but I did it already. I did it anyway.
So Holdo was the big load.
That was my favorite moment.
So you didn't. Most
of the moments that stick out for me right now are like comedic moments. I guess the Yoda cameo.
That was one of the best moments of the
movie.
That was
a great moment. Just in terms of seeing Yoda as we remember him in the original trilogy, as opposed to the very stoic, serious Yoda of the prequels.
Yeah, it was a return to Yoda in, like, impish form, mischievous laughing,
giggling. Like, striking the thing with fucking lightning. Yeah.
And espousing, like, in one scene, he's just dishing you with, like, so much wisdom for the rest of your life.
Yeah, totally.
Okay.
The moment where he says, failure the best teacher is. Was like that's such a true.
He said the best teacher of failure is sorry.
Oh,
just
the best
correcting
teacher.
Your Yoda syntax.
The best teacher of failure is.
Yeah.
That's such a truism. It's such a great lesson.
That like,
you know, if these movies really are for kids, that's such a great
that
lesson.
That is an amazing lesson to teach kids, and it's also something that like so many of us as adults haven't even learned how to properly.
Well, because our society,
we're so afraid of failure. Yeah.
Our society demonizes failure.
Yeah, absolutely.
In so many ways, in so many.
And it's so interesting because it's like, I don't know. Yeah, it is. It's a very interesting thing because you, especially
it's capitalism.
Like, yeah,
that's what it is. That's capitalism.
But they talk about like, you know, there's that saying that if you see an overnight success, they've actually been doing it for 10 years.
It takes 20 years to be an overnight success.
Yeah, 10 or 20 years. Yeah, I think it's 10 years. It takes 10 years to be an overnight success. And like, it's funny to see that because, yeah, like, it is. It's such a real thing. We're so afraid of failure. We demonize it. So many people don't try at all.
Right.
Because you're so afraid of failing. Because, yeah, exactly.
Yeah, don't,
failure.
Don't, or just don't take risks.
Don't take risks because like taking risks is so hard and so scary.
Because it can destroy
ruin
your
life. Exactly. You know, like for everybody that gets success.
You don't incentivize people to, even in schools,
yeah.
If failure is not incentivized.
Incentivized, exactly.
Or not incentivized, but success is so much of the, you know, the and we tie it to people's jobs and how much money they make.
And their worth as people. Like, you see someone who becomes poor and you have all these people going, oh, they're going food stamps. Oh, well, I work hard for my money and all this kind of nonsense. And it's like, it, you know, it just, it all goes into that idea.
Yeah,
that, like, 100%. Somehow, yeah, you're a failure if you don't want to work a job that you hate for 50 years because you want to maybe do something that, like, if you're successful at, would benefit a million people,
yeah,
you know,
just
right now.
People think of failure in, like, social Darwinism terms.
Yeah,
of,
it
like,
is.
Failure weeds out the weak.
Yeah.
No, everybody has to fucking fail. You ask any of the most successful people in the world, how many times they failed before they succeeded.
That's what's so funny to me is that, like, and I know you're going to roll your eyes at me because I'm going to talk about Adam Driver. But, like, Adam Driver is the total proof that it takes 10 years to become an overnight success. He, like, started when he was a kid, and he joined the military. What? Oh, am I sorry? My feet?
That might end up on the
Oh, I'm so sorry. If you hear a weird shuffling, no, that's my feet. He started, you know, he joined the military because he failed trying to get to California to become an actor.
Oh, wow.
And so he didn't know, you know, and then 9/11 happened and he didn't know what else to do and he felt patriotic, so he joined the military. He served 2 years. Before he could go, he broke his sternum and scrubbed out and and got honorably discharged, medical discharge.
Wow.
So then he said, okay, let me audition for Juilliard, which he had already done before and had failed at.
Yeah.
And by the way, Juilliard, you only get 2 tries.
Oh, wow.
So if you get rejected once, you get rejected the second time, you can never apply again. You're done. So he applied the second time, he got in, and then he's been working since he got in to become an actor. And now, almost 10 years later, yeah, because he's only, like, 2 years older than me, he's now, like, super famous.
Mm-hmm.
And but, like, he's the perfect example. Like, people want to look at him. And that's what's funny is because looking at the way people write about him, they want to be like, oh, my God, he just, like, blew up. Like, no, he didn't just blow up. He's been working really fucking hard for the past 10 fucking years of his life. And that's the thing is, like, he works, like, and so it's so funny because, like, the greatest teacher failure is, like, you can even see it in some of the stories of the actors, because it's not just him. John Boyega, Daisy Ridley, so many of them, they fucking failed. They've been working for years. Like, this is not something that they just, like, did, you know? They've been working forever, and they've been doing stuff forever, and then now it's like, oh, okay, we got lucky, you know? Like, and we,
and like, if anyone knows how much you can learn from failure, fucking Yoda failed big time in
the prequels. Over and over again, yeah.
He failed so hard. He failed to recognize Sidious right under his fucking nose.
Yeah.
He failed to keep Anakin from turning to the, you know.
It was so cool to see Luke Skywalker say Darth Sidious out loud and to, like, you know, recognize that, like,
that was never
Luke has finally, like,
a thing.
He's learned all this history that now we know. Like, Luke has seen the prequels too now.
I don't think they ever call him that in the original trilogy, do they?
No, never, no.
What?
Darth Sidious.
No, they never did.
That's all prequels, yeah.
The other thing that Yoda says in that scene is, he ends with, they are what we grow beyond.
Oh, yeah, masters, we're talking about being masters.
Being a master.
Our apprentices are what we, they
the
are
The masters
what,
grow beyond.
We are what they grow beyond, yeah.
Yoda's such
that
a...
That was such a great...
And that shit just, like, breaks your heart and, like, blows your mind and, like, just, you know, says everything
the
about
idea,
life and death and, like,
well, just the
know,
idea
legacy.
Of Yoda acknowledging, like, it's my job to, like...
Let them
to guide the next Jedi to be even more powerful than me. The idea that he imagines the next Jedi, the person that is his apprentice, being even more powerful than him, is like, wow. Like, Yoda, like, we all think of Yoda, that's like, that's the most powerful Jedi
ever
been. And I guess he, you know, at this point, you could maybe make the argument that Luke became more powerful than him.
Yeah,
I think that fucking force projecting shit.
Yeah.
I don't know if Yoda ever fucking did that.
Across the galaxy.
Across the fucking galaxy, yeah.
All Yoda ever did was learn how to figure out how to backflip. Dumbass puppet.
But yeah, no, I think it's such a good, cool thing to put Yoda in the middle of the movie because Yoda was basically telling, if he was telling the lesson to all the children, like, this is what you should take away from this movie.
Exactly, totally.
Like, that you shouldn't hold on to the past so much.
Kylo Ren's message. I have an issue with people that have an issue with Yoda's lightsaber fighting style.
Oh, yeah?
Which is, and now, I didn't even realize it. Well, it's, so, that flippy, crazy form of light, there's like, official, like, different forms. Yeah. Of lights, that is form one, form two. They all have weird names. I don't remember.
No, they do. They have very weird names.
But the one of the forms is that is like a really like a lot of flips, a lot of misdirection, that kind of stuff. And I think it's one of the first ones that you learn. So Yoda, we see in the prequels, he teaches the younglings.
He's like basically.
So he's probably teaching them form two,
mm-hmm.
and. So it makes sense that that's the one that he knows the best, that he's the most familiar with in that moment. Mm. There's actually a great moment in the novel of Revenge of the Sith, where it's with the lightsaber battle between Anakin and Dooku after Obi-Wan gets knocked out,
mm-hmm.
and it talks about how he's fighting in form two for half of the battle. And then at some point, he, like, suddenly changes to form three. And at that point, Dooku's totally taken off guard. And from that point on, he's, like, he's still fighting him. But he's, like, I'm going to lose. He's going to beat me. It's inevitable. He's going to beat me. I wasn't ready for this. He's way more powerful than I realized.
Yeah.
And ultimately, he does beat him.
Yeah.
Which is super cool.
That is cool.
Yeah. But, no, my favorite moment from the Revenge of the Sith novel is, there's that moment, like, after Anakin turns and he comes back to Padme to mm-hmm. check on her, and C-3PO is talking to R2-D2, and there's a moment between C-3PO and R2-D2. R2-D2 says something, and C-3PO goes, well, he has been under a lot of stress. And in the book, what R2 says there is, Anakin, stop talking to me. Isn't that just, like, heartbreaking? Like,
I hate it.
Oh, my God.
Thanks, I hate it.
Poor R2.
I know, it's so sad.
Thanks, I hate it.
And that's why R2 crawled up into a world of sadness.
Yeah, right?
R2's the saddest after droid the in the fucking galaxy, dude.
That's why he's so fucking foul-mouthed. He's just like, I hate all these people. Fuck all of you.
I'm too old for this shit.
I've seen some shit, man.
That's why he's painted blue, because he's seen that he has the blues.
No, did you know what made me cry the other day? I watched, you know, I haven't watched all of Attack of Rebels and Attack of the Clones and stuff, but I know enough about it, so I watched...
Clone Wars, you mean?
Clone Wars, yeah, and Rebels now.
And Rebels.
Yeah, and I know enough about it, and I watched the Ahsoka fight Darth Vader scene, and like...
Who is
Ahsoka?
Ahsoka Tano was in the Clone Wars,
The whole
Anakin
point of the Clone
took
Wars...
took an apprentice.
Is Anakin an apprentice? Who's a chick?
So, yeah, a chick. Ahsoka Tano. And she's an alien... A Twi'lek, right? Isn't that what
no,
she is?
No,
she's not a Twi'lek. What's a Twi'lek?
She's similar to Twi'lek, but she's got, like, a
she's
split,
something
dual,
of the
Twi'lek,
yeah.
The fin
but, no, I think she's a Twi'lek.
Was this, like, unsanctioned by anybody?
No, this is...
No,
because he's not a master.
No, but this is in between when he's a... Before... Well, in Revenge of the Sith, he's supposed to become a Jedi master and be a master on the council.
Yeah.
But they never give him his full mastership. But while he's a knight and he's like about to be a Jedi master for the Clone Wars,
he has his war apprentice.
Yeah.
Okay.
They give him like an apprentice because, and the thing about Ahsoka is she kind of rejects the Jedi way. So she actually is not, she does
that
not.
That makes sense, learning from Anakin,
she does not,
he's so jaded about the
Jedi
way.
She was also very beat up by the Jedi and also because of what happened to him. So she kind of rejects the Jedi way. So she's not a Jedi or a Sith, she's her own thing.
Yeah.
And there's a moment when she fights him as Darth Vader and she sees him for the first time. And it made me cry because so much of the dialogue mirrors like what Kylo said to his father,
because
he's like, I'll share you the link later, but she's like, Anakin, it's, you know, are you in there? And like, at one point she knocks off a piece of his mask and she can just see his yellow eye and like the scarring in his face. And she's like, and he's like, you're in there, Anakin, it's you. And he's like, Anakin Skywalker is dead. he was weak, and I killed him. Fuck. And it's so much like fucking what Kylo said to Han that I was like, oh my god. I was like, why are you like your grandfather? You're so stupid! Like, and then she it ends, like, they think she refuses to leave him. So she's, like, fighting him. And, like, they have a really cool lightsaber fight. I gotta show you the link. It's really cool. Yeah. And they're having an awesome lightsaber fight. And then, like, she stays with him to fight him. And, like, because she wants to, like, I guess she wants to kill him to save him or something. Like, yeah, but it's really cool. She becomes... When Ahsoka Tano first came out, I remember a lot of controversy. Like, why the fuck does Anakin have a fucking apprentice? This is another piece of bullshit, whatever. Yeah. But, like, it was cool because she became, like, such a popular character because she came very much in her own. And she's the reason, like, I really want to watch Clone Wars and Rebels because I like her character a lot. Anyway, so I guess did you already do your second thing? You did your
second thing. That was a great Ahsoka Tano point. I think that's the perfect point in which the podcast... to wrap this podcast up.
Oh, yeah?
If we're going to do a part two. This is already quite lengthy.
Okay. Yeah. I told you it's going to be 4 hours long.
Apparently, that's what you
We've been holding in so much discussion. I don't understand why you're getting angry about it.
About
everything. I do. I don't understand why you're surprised. You know how I've been since this movie came out.
I know, but I thought we could have a clear, concise...
Then you should be a better moderator.
I am, but you don't listen to me. You don't pay attention to my fucking physical cues here.
I don't want physical, I want verbal.
Verbal?
You need to say
but
stop.
You don't listen to me.
That's not true.
But it's rude, and I sound like a toxic masculine if I'm like, stop speaking, woman, so I can talk
That's
about...
That's exactly how you have to say it.
Ryan Johnson's
film. No, you could say, something like,
penis.
Hold that thought and let's
move on.
You can
say that to somebody with their consent. That's... You know.
Yeah.
There's
you
such
could also
a thing
say,
as...
hold that thought, let's move on.
No, but you always look at me like, fuck you, I had 12 more points I was working on there.
Whatever.
We have a lot to say, Steven.
Thank
let's
you. What the
it.
Fuck? He acts like I'm the only one talking
we
here.
Do this...
Derek and I are fucking having essays with each other.
We do the same thing on every podcast. We do this on our wrestling podcast. We wander off onto tangents all over the place.
I'm trying to control this podcast.
It's not working.
It's not getting
I'm
you
trying.
Can't. It's uncontrollable.
All right, part two.
I've been your host, Steven. That was Danielle. That's Derek talking. And remember, kids, failure the best teacher is, as that podcast was a failure, according to Danielle.
It's not
and my lack of control.
This is bullshit. I'm angry right now. Don't you put this on me. It's
what?
Not a failure. It's us having fun and talking.
I'm joking.
I didn't realize
remember kids
that this had become
the remember kids.
Food is sad.
Finally,
and I didn't want to
do the
deal.
Remember kids. Fucking complainer.
Remember kids. Steven can't moderate chats for shit. Go. Come on.
No, it's ending on that.
Yeah, it's ending
on that. Everyone's going to be sad.
Oh. Just like the end of this movie.
This movie ended sad? No.
Half sad, bittersweet.
It's
bittersweet.
Yeah.
No.
Yeah.
The spark
hope.
Lives.
There's hope.
But
there's hope.
Yeah.
There's hope at the end of Empire, too,
yeah.
But it's still depressing.
Yeah, exactly.
Hey, Vunda.
Vundacast? Give it up for Vundacast, man. What an adorable name.
You're listening to the Vundacast.
What's up, everybody? This is Jason David Frank, Green Ranger. Listening to Vundacast.
Subscribe to the Vundacast.